Good afternoon. I'm Jenny Blessing, Senior Curator of Photography at the Guggenheim Museum, and I would like to welcome you to today's panel, Wearing Masks, the Performance of Identity in Contemporary Art. Could I have the first slide, please? Contemporary artists. I would also like to thank Alan Seiss, Manager of Public Programs, and Brenda Gray, Director of Theater Operations, and her team for making this event possible. Could I have the next slide, please? Today's panel is presented in conjunction with the Guggenheim's exhibition, Gillian Wearing Masks, on view until June 13th, which I co-organized with my colleague, Nat Troutman, Curator of Performance and Media. Nat and I collaborated with Ksenia Noel, Assistant Curator, and Ksenia M. Soboleva, the former Jana Marika Vilcek Curatorial Fellow at the Guggenheim. Dr. Soboleva, who is now the Andrew W. Mellon Postdoctoral Fellow in Gender and LGBTQ plus History at the New York Historical Society, kindly agreed to organize and moderate this panel, and she will introduce our esteemed artist panelists. But first, I'm going to present some themes around the performance of identity in Gillian Wearing's work as a way to contextualize today's program. For almost 30 years, British conceptual artist Gillian Wearing has been using masks both as literal props and as metaphors for the daily performances each of us stage as individuals. Her work questions fixed notions of identity and tests the boundaries between the private and public. Could I have the next slide, please? In 1994, for her piece, Confess All on Video, Wearing provided participants with store-bought novelty masks and wigs to preserve their anonymity. Next slide, please. For Self-Portrait 2000, Wearing photographed herself in a plastic mask that was made from a cast of her face. Next slide. For her family album series made between 2003 and 6, she deployed silicone prosthetics, wigs, and lighting to disguise herself as members of her family of origin as they appear in old snapshots. Here you see three of these self-portraits as her father, brother, and herself at 17. Could I have the next slide, please? With her ongoing series, Spiritual Family, Wearing produced similarly constructed images of herself as members of her family of choice, pivotal art historical figures with whom she feels creative kinship. Here you see the first three photographs in this series. The high resolution images reveal the artifice of the carefully wrought masks and costumes Wearing wears in the photographs, documenting a performance for the camera, a theatrical presentation of self at the intersection of art and life. Wearing calls these reenactments of embodiment, there are 14 so far, homages to artists whose work she admires. Collectively, they assert a feminist claim that Arbus is equally as important as Warhol, George O'Keeffe is as important as Durer, and Wearing herself stands among these revered elders. Could I have the next slide, please? This piece marks the beginning of Wearing's engagement with the work of French surrealist writer, artist, and activist Claude Cahun, which is the pseudonym for Lucy Schwab. In their writing, image-making, and daily life, Cahun conceived of identity as a mask and gender as mutable. Next slide, please. Wearing was inspired by this self-portrait of Cahun from circa 1927, which you see on the left. In many of the French artist's images, the personas Cahun posits are non-binary. Gender polarities collapse into a single multivalent subject or multiply into a diverse panoply of selves. Cahun's refusal to accept being pinned down to any one identity, her rejection of social norms or expectations that limited her experiences and possibilities, as well as her radical politics, have made her a much admired iconic figure. Could I have the next slide, please? Made in 2018, the projected video you see here, Wearing Gillian, is a synthesis of the artist's explorations to date of the masquerade of identity and selfhood. Scripted around a seemingly candid statement of her artistic purpose, the 5-minute video takes the form of a promotional piece about wearing herself. More than a dozen actors appear in the piece, their faces, bodies, and voices digitally morphed with the artists and each other's to create myriad hybrid versions of a deepfake persona. Like much of Wearing's work, the video includes references to earlier pieces as well as performances within performances and masks worn over masks. Next, please. On the left is one of several small photographs Wearing made of herself, seemingly unmasked, with Claude Cahun as her reflection or twin. On the right is the catalog for the first show I curated, Rose is a Rose is a Rose, Gender Performance and Photography. The cover features a self-portrait of Claude Cahun, probably shot by her life partner, Marcel Moore, which is a pseudonym for Suzanne Malherbe. Can I have the next slide, please? The title of the Rose exhibition referenced the name of Marcel Duchamp's alter ego, Eros C'est la Vie, seen here on the left in Wearing's oversized locket diptych. But Claude Cahun was the artist whose work most influenced the conceptualization of the show. Could I have the next slide, please? I'm drawn to the identities Cahun and Wearing explore in their self-portraiture because they are unfixed, unnatural, and inauthentic, or rather authentic in their inauthenticity. I would argue that the pleasure this kind of work provides is not about identification or the gaze, and it's not necessarily or entirely about empathy. It has more to do with finding kindred spirits across time and space and place. It's about recognition and sharing an experience of life that somehow validates one's own existence. As a curator, my job is to provide platforms for artists to tell their stories. Like Wearing, the histories I narrate are ultimately mine, sometimes metaphorically masked as those of others. In conclusion, I'd like to give Gillian Wearing the last word of this introduction and play a 1-minute video of the artist reading from Claude Cahun's indescribable book, Disavowed Confessions. I have the next slide and video, please.
Under this mask, another mask. I will never finish removing all these faces. The lens tracks the eyes, the mouth, the wrinkles skin deep. The expression on the face is fierce, sometimes tragic, and then calm, a knowing calm, worked on, flashy, a professional smile, and voila. The handheld mirror reappears, and the rouge and the eyeshadow. A beat, full stop, new paragraph. Shuffle the cards, masculine, feminine, it depends on the situation. Neuter is the only gender that always suits me. Individualism, narcissism, certainly. My best characteristic, the one and only intentional fidelity I'm capable of. You don't care, I'm lying anyway. I scatter myself too widely for that.
Thank you, Jenny, and thank you to everyone at the Guggenheim who made this event possible, especially the public programs team. As Jenny mentioned, I had the pleasure of working on the Gillian Wearing Masks exhibition as the Wilczek Curatorial Fellow at the Guggenheim. And when Nat and Jenny invited me back to organize a panel in conjunction with the exhibition, I wanted to think about masks as a larger framework for the performance of identity in art. In 1956, the sociologist Irving Goffman proposed in his renowned book, The Presentation of Self in Everyday Life, that we are constantly wearing masks and performing roles while at the same time witnessing the performances of others. So we are simultaneously actor and audience. And Goffman is actually somebody that Wearing is very informed by. While I think that the performance of identity has always been a subject of interest for artists in some way, it gained particular resonance with the rise of identity politics in the 1970s and was accompanied by a rigorous discourse with the proliferation of queer theory in the 90s. artists started thinking about the ways in which identity is something constructed and informed by power structures that marginalize people based on gender, sexuality, race, and class. But instead of having another art history conference about the performance of identity, I was interested in inviting artists whose work engages with the identity of performance in compelling ways and across different media, and who have been on my mind recently because of their exhibitions in New York in recent years. And so it is my absolute honor and pleasure to be introducing today's speakers, and I will read their bios in the order that they will be presenting. Farah Al Qasimi is an artist based in Brooklyn and Dubai who works in photography, video, and performance. She teaches at Bard College in New York. Her work has been featured in exhibitions at Public Art Fund New York, Contemporary Art Museum St. Louis, Jameel Arts Centre Dubai, Liss Visual Arts Centre Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and Museum of Contemporary Art in Toronto. Her work is in the collections of the Museum of Modern Art, the Solomon R. Guggenheim Museum, the Guggenheim Abu Dhabi, the Tate Modern, the Museum of Contemporary Art Chicago, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and House Marseille in Amsterdam. Al Qasimi received her BA from Yale University and her MFA from the Yale School of Art. Her first monograph, Hello Future, published by Capricious in 2021, was shortlisted for the Aperture Paris Photo Book Award of the Year Award. Next, Malik Gaines is an artist, writer, and composer based in New York. He has collaborated for 2 decades with Jade Gordon and Alexander Sagade as the performance group My Barbarian, presenting their work at the Museum of Modern Art New York, Los Angeles County Museum of Art, and San Francisco Museum of Modern Art, among many other institutions, galleries, and performance spaces. A 20-year survey of their work was presented at the Whitney Museum of American Art New York in 2021. I hope everyone saw that. Gaines is the co-artistic director of The Industry, an experimental opera company in Los Angeles. He is the author of many articles and essays about art and performance and the book Black Performance on the Outskirts of the Left, published by NYU Press in 2017. And he's currently associate professor of performance studies at New York University's Tisch School of the Arts. And last, we have Colette Lumiere. Colette Lumiere is a pioneering artist who first became recognized for her enigmatic street art and soon after her elaborate living tableau and environments. Her vast enduring body of work has innovated and defied the categories of installation, performance, photography, and painting from the early 1970s through the present. Widely known as Colette, she began using a series of personas in 1978 to create her art, including Justine, Mata Hari and the Stolen Potatoes, Countess Reichenbach, The House of Olympia, and Lumiere. Colette's artwork is in the collections of the Solomon R. Guggenheim Museum, Museum of Contemporary Art Los Angeles, Brooklyn Museum, the Aldrich Contemporary Art Museum, Museum Ludwig in Cologne, Kunstmuseum Wolfsburg, and the Berlinische Gallery, among others. Her exhibition, Notes on Baroque Living, Colette and Her Living Environment, featured seminal works from the first decade of her ever-evolving career, and it was on view at Company Gallery New York earlier this year. And so thank you everyone for being here. I'm so excited to hear your presentations. And with that, Farah, I'll hand it over to you.
Thank you so much. I'm just going to share my screen and talk to you about a couple of ways that performance and masking have made their way into my practice. So I was born and raised in the United Arab Emirates, and I had a very particular relationship to public space in the sense that public space was and still very much is in certain ways segregated by gender. So I had a very different experience growing up than that of, you know, some of the boys that I was growing up with. And because of that, I ended up spending a lot of my childhood on this amazing computer, which shockingly still, I think, turns on. But I spent so much time at this computer playing PC games as different characters, pretending I was a pirate or, I don't know, Duke Nukem or, you know, any suite of characters that was completely the opposite of my actual demographic. And I would also, when the internet came around, spend time on different forums and websites, specifically forums about punk music, because that's what I was into at the time. And there was not very much of a scene in the Emirates. So I felt like there was a lot of freedom and anonymity that the computer and the internet afforded me. and a lot of my friends in my immediate community, that really became transformative for us when we were able to have access to the digital world and all of its different joys. So this idea of masking or anonymity eventually made its way into my practice when I was working on a series of portraits of people in the Emirates. And I wanted to think about their relationship to me as well. And so I ended up incorporating a sort of sub-project called Make Me Beautiful, where I was commissioning professional studio photographers to photograph me just wearing what I had been wearing that day. And I'd walk in and say, please make me beautiful. And then they would completely interpret that up to their own volition and their own idea of what could possibly make a beautiful portrait of somebody. And so this was great because I felt like the photographs were not really about me. It was about the people who were seeing me, and it was about what they wanted to see in me. And that was a really important counterpart to some of the work that I continue to do, specifically pertaining to portraiture of the people around me, the people that I love, that I know, that I make art with. And, you know, I became really, really interested in actually formalizing what some of those relationships were that we had with the internet and with the world at large through being able to be anonymous and just kind of remain behind, you know, this this digital wall. So on the left is one of my best friends watching an anime that we grew up with. She spends a lot of time gaming online and meeting friends around the world through gaming. And so another thing at play here is the way that portraiture constantly demands a sense of visibility is something that I try to push up against in photography or in response to the history of photography. But I kept thinking about this idea of performing identity as one that could actually be aided from a lack of visibility or anonymity. And that, you know, somebody being invisible or not necessarily being seen isn't a way of obscuring the truth, but in fact, it could create more avenues for the truth to be amplified and to be apparent, because there is this pressure lifted of, well, what do I look like? Instead, it's what do I feel like? You know, what do I, what gesture am I making? How do I feel in the space that I'm in? This is something that is also particular to how people are in their personal spaces, in their domestic spaces. You know, like I mentioned before, those spaces are so important for so many young women, and to really think about how these spaces reflect our best versions of ourselves back to us is an incredibly important part of the work that I've been doing and continue to do. My relationship to music was also sort of important here in the sense that when I quit music, I started making video and thinking about, you know, who I could be in these different modes of storytelling. So here I'm an influencer who got bit by a jellyfish and turned into an anime. Here I'm a puppet who doesn't have a mouth, and so she uses other puppets to talk for her. Here I'm a clown who's learning how to communicate human emotion. And then in this last video, which I will turn over to the Guggenheim tech team to play, I play myself as a teenager being surveilled by NSA and by my parents and by a lot of other different people. So thank you for listening, and I think we'll now watch the video. We'll be right back.
It's just not fair. I have such thick and kinky hair. Maybe I can fix some stuff in it to help me fix it up.
Hi. Now I can hear you. Farah, what if you say something? Or Colette?
Sure, I can try to say something. Can you hear me?
Okay. Yeah, I can hear you. I can hear Colette. Yes.
Well, for me,
I could.
You can hear.
Okay, so then maybe let's jump over to Colette. While
oh no, okay, whatever, whatever works.
Thank you.
So, do we see the images? Is that how we go about it? And he can't come on, huh? Oh, next slide, please. How do I do this? Next slide. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Next slide. Can you hear me? Wait. Actually, I want to. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So I'd like to stop for a minute because the first image was showing the six personas that I've used during the long range of my work, a few decades. And now we're on to the early street works where I painted the streets from the early 70s, and I still use the streets. Can you hear me? Next slide, please. Yeah, this is a very early street work where I painted anatomy. I painted the streets anonymously, okay? Next slide. I don't see the slides.
Yeah, nothing happened.
Technical
issues. Wait, hold on.
Everything okay there? I don't see the slides. Images? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, Colette. I think there's something. I think maybe the Guggenheim computer broke.
Oh no, we're in trouble. Maybe we have to redo this.
I think that maybe we should have it in person.
We can talk if we can, I don't know. At least we saw one artist. I learned something new today. Thank you.
Yes, that was so wonderful, Farah. Thank you. Well, actually, you know what? While we're troubleshooting, I do have a question for Farah already, since she presented. Farah, I always think of your work as really exploring cultural identity as a mask, and but also visualizing what remains hidden, because actually you rarely show the faces of your sitters, and it's not common for you to include yourself in your work as well. And when you do, from what I've seen at least, it's primarily in your video and film work. So I was wondering, what is it about the medium of video that that makes you open to, I guess, inhabiting that space in front of the camera?
That's a great question. I think there's something about the way that narrative works with video, where there's a little bit more control over what story unfolds, where I think with the images, there's so much more room for interpretation. And that's a generalization, so I'm only saying it about the way that I work specifically with both mediums. And so I think that it enables me to craft a very particular world. And in doing that, I can create a sort of neat character that I can inhabit. More so than when the photograph is rooted in reality and it's a little bit more open-ended, then I feel like there's more of myself that could come in. But I think we might actually be able to go back to Colette, so should we give that a shot?
Let's do that.
Okay, so we were on the street works, my early works from the 70s, and I was exploring space. And I was creating them anonymously. I would paint them early in the morning hours normally, because I learned when I was doing it as a public performance, I would get arrested. I still got arrested, but I tried not to be. So, and then simulate, we can go on. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is another street work, The Lips on 57th Street. I was arrested, but thank God I finished the piece. Next. Okay, simultaneous at the same time, okay? I was creating indoor spaces. I was exploring space outside from the canvas. This was an idea that was explored at the time anyway. And I created an artwork in my own space and I kept transforming it. And interestingly enough, my last show was about this iconic work, which somehow influenced a lot of other works and still does at Company Gallery, and it wasn't that long ago. Next. So as I was transforming my space, this is a very, very early tableau performance. And that's me, and one of the early ones, which is homage to Delacroix, you know, the painting of the woman bare-breasted leading the revolution. We continue. Next slide. Okay, this is a little later. The first space you saw was more minimal. They were artworks, the floor was painted. By this time, I was creating entire spaces that were completely covered with silk satins, often incorporated audios and other art. So this was real dream at the clock tower 75. And this was kind of a scandalous work. It was a big box and I was sleeping inside of it for a month, still over a month actually. Continue, please. I would sleep very often in my work. Now, this is a work that went on before my first living persona. My real name is Colette, okay? Named after the famous writer. But this was a piece called Encore à Tout, where I actually lived in it. Most of my rooms and artworks in the 70s were themes from literature, mythology, art history. Camille, Wake of Madame Récamier, Persephone's Bedroom. But this work was more like autobiographical. It was very similar to the space I lived in. Next, Cologne. This is Cologne 77. And so by that time, I had become quite well known worldwide, globally. And my image was imitated by the commercial world as well as it influenced art. So I didn't know what to do with it because I was struggling to make these works, you know. And they were, so I invented my death. I had a chance at the Whitney downtown in 78 in a show called Out of the House, where I transported part of my room and I died with a staple gun. Here we go, next slide. And resurrected as Justine and the Victorian Punks, which was a visual art band. And as Justine, I was able to rip myself off, which is, I became a pop singer, a fashion designer, interior designer. I conceptualized products that were inspired by Colette's image. I went under the name Justine, my first living persona. And I even was the head of my estate. So this is me as Joan of Arc and ripping myself off. Next. There's a lot of material, so I don't want to be here. Okay, now there were recurring themes. I was always playing with this idea of transformation, the big interest, transformation. I was also exploring the line between art and life, art and commerce, dreams and reality. And thrift shops were a favorite theme. And this is a thrift shop I did in an actual thrift shop. I moved my own in 1983, I think, 82. Next. This is the band, Justine and the Victorian Punks, 78 at PS1 was the first time. And I actually did music. First, it was a visual art band. Next. And this is, oh, I slept in windows. Okay, so I did street works. I created environments modeled in a way after my living space, but they had a different theme, okay? Like a painter that has a style and then you have a different painting, but the same artist. So this was, as Justine, I had slept in the windows. Windows were a favorite because I created inner space and the streets were exploration of outer space. My work is very personal, but at the same time, I try to speak and be universal to a larger audience. So the windows were perfect because it provided an inner space that was private and it was open to the public, to any kind of audience, which I love. I love reaching pieces, people of all range. This was for the fashion show at the Mud Club. Many of you may have heard of the Mud Club. And Fiorucci, a year later, asked me to design a line of clothes, the Deadly Feminine line. That was my trademark. And I did a fashion show at the Mud Club. And this is 1979, a year after I had done the window, because my look had inspired the store Fiorucci, which was like the in store in New York City. Next. Okay, then I did, I love to do things outside of just, even though I was well known and did things in museums and traditional galleries, I always loved doing things in unorthodox art spaces, and the nightclubs became a favorite. And so here was a danceteria, 1980, when it opened, Fuck Art, Let's Dance, which I did a video of. There would be different ways of exploring the same idea, different medias. So this is an installation called Fuck Art, Let's Dance, and later on I did a video, and so on and so forth. Next. Okay, this is moving forward. There was Justine, then I was in, Justine lived in the environment, and then I was invited by the city of Berlin to, on the DAD grant, to live there for 1 year. I lived there 2 years and had dismantled the environment. And by 1983, I was also going back to painting, my original source of expression, but I always work with multimedia. So there would always be a performance, multimedia works, light boxes. And this is when I already took down the environment. These were paintings I did in the 80s, early 80s. Next. Okay, as in Berlin, I became Mata Hari and the Stolen Potatoes. And with that theme, which was inspired by the intrigue of Berlin in the 80s before the wall came down, I did a whole series of work. This is a billboard of me as Mata Hari carrying her stolen potatoes. Next. Okay. This is also before I went to Berlin, but I continued to make works similar to these, and these were called Headless Women. Sometimes they actually had a head, like a lampshade. So I continued to make these. They're altars, but I still like the idea of these light pieces. And this is before I went to Berlin, but I continued to make similar works. Continue, please. Next slide. Okay, this is Mata Hari and the Stolen Potatoes. Actually, this was presented in New York right before I went to Berlin, a danceteria on stage with my friends. And then with that image and that idea, you know, the personas give birth and then they evolve on their own like a child. You know, you don't know where they're going and they go. And so this was the beginning. Next. Next slide. And now I'm in Munich. Okay, this is my apartment in Munich, the Reichenbach Palace, I called it because, oh, it's too long a story, but to make a long story short, Munich was a city of Ludwig, the King Ludwig, an aristocracy. So I call myself Countess Reichenbach. But I had a boyfriend whose mother was Countess Reichenbach, and I lived on Reichenbachstrasse. So that's how that person came about. And I continued with multimedia works, and different series came about as a result of my personal life and what was going on in the world and the inspiration of the location. Next. Next slide. I did windows in Munich. I also did a Darcy for Scandal service as a series because I found, me and my boyfriend found Munich very boring. So we tried to make a scandal service because people were so bored. They were inviting me to parties and I was getting bored with it. So I made a scandal service and I made images. So they'd have to hire me supposedly. Next. Okay, this is the scandal services. There were images that were actually different from this one, but this is my office. The telephones were very important. I had hundreds of telephones. And this is me ready to go on a scandal on the telephone. And the bathtub is my office. Okay, next. Okay, then I went back to New York, okay? After quite a few years in exile in Munich. And by then I came back to New York and it was really interesting. I saw my influence again all over the place, but where was I? I was in Germany, I was in Europe. So I opened the House of Olympia. I kept transforming my loft, even though the original complete Gesamtkunstwerk came down in 1983. I kept transforming the loft according to the persona. So now it was the House of Olympia. a homage to the 18th century, an inspiration of the 18th century, and totally politically incorrect at the time, of heavy feminism and aggression and current events in art. I wanted art that celebrated life and elevated the spirit, and that was not somehow very popular. Next. So this is a painting as in an 18th century costume. Oh, okay. So the House of Olympia had many rules. One of them was retrieving my history. And this show, looking through the looking glass, showed earlier works a little bit like works that were shown in company, like right now. And they showed fragments of my environment, the uniforms I would wear as Justine Part Two, that looked like my environments, and an experiment in walking architecture. Next. Tell me if I'm taking too long, because I have such a long history. Olympia also was replaced very often with a Colette mannequin sculpture. And you can see this this is not me, it's a mannequin. And it was a show called, The House of Olympia, The Ruins and Rise of the House of Olympia. And it had works from the 18th century, Colette size. Next slide. Okay, now I'm in Berlin. Again, I'm invited. Maison Lumière, we kind of skipped it. I have a whole book of Maison Lumière, okay? I don't know if you can see this, but we skipped to my time in Berlin, and where I called it Laboratoire Lumière, because I had lost my Maison Lumière, my studio on Pearl Street. And I used this image of the woman with a mask, because for me, the mask makes for anonymity. And it's like hiding your identity, okay? Well, the personas for me can be used to reveal your inner self or your deeper self, your inspired self. So I had posted images of this woman with a golden mask, which was from an earlier performance in Venice, because there were so many artists in Berlin, you know, and everybody wanted to be famous and rich. And there were so many. So I posted this woman. I was new to Berlin. Berlin had changed. I spent so much time in Berlin, but it was a new city. So I was becoming known again as anonymous. The woman with the golden mask. Next. Okay, this is from the later works I did in Berlin, not that long ago, of a series where I went to Zululand, Africa. And this is me, Lumière and the Lion, I think. And I had a series called where I was actually in Africa and took pictures and did three mixed media works and installation all about Zululand. Next. This is PS1 2016, an earlier work from the Rauschenbach, you know, from Munich. But it was put in the attic with a totally new works, new installations. And it was an attic. So I showed old works, new works, and it was a major new, quite monumental installation. Next slide, please. Okay, this was the mermaid in the attic. And actually there was another installation where you see that black hole that should have been lit up, where it was a homage to Marcel Duchamp. And I was actually in the piece, you could see me in the mirror. It was a homage to Marcel Duchamp's Étant Donné's last work. And it was very mysterious. And it didn't have much to do with this work, the main work, but it kind of worked together. And throughout the attic, I had my works from different periods. And this was 2016, and I had the Colette mannequin sculpture in one installation and Me Live in the other. Next. Okay, now we're back to the Back to the Future, oh, to the Past. This is Company Gallery 2022. And this reconstruction of my environment, the Colette sculpture is actually a collaboration with a wonderful artist that also shows with the gallery, Kasia van Lidzidel. Wonderful. And so she made the upper corso with an old gown. And this was a new work in a very old work. And I showed works from that period. Next, because you'll have slides that show some of the installation. Yes, the same exhibition at Company. These were walls from the environment, the costume. You can see how I recycle things and ideas and visual photographs from performance to 3D. Continue, please. Next slide. And this is downstairs at Company, where the walls of an environment, which was my tomb at PS1, are also artworks, and where you can see early light boxes of myself. And then right there was the messenger, a very early light box. I think these all date 1978. That was a tomb I did at PS1 for Justine. Justine created a tomb for Colette. That's it. So much more, but thank you.
Thank you, Colette. That was fantastic.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yep. Great. So thank you. Thank you so much to the artists. Always so interesting to meet people this way. And thank you, Ksenia and the Guggenheim and everyone working there on this. Alan, maybe you could just go back to the beginning of the presentation and then just play each slide for like 30 seconds and I'll just talk for a couple minutes. Is that okay? I'm here. You know, I thought I would speak about the work of My Barbarian, which is a group that I work with that's made up of me and Jade Gordon and Alexandra Sagadi. And we've been doing performance work for more than 20 years. The work is live performance, it's video, performance for video, it's cited in galleries, it's cited in public spaces, and it also works in theater and music venues. So one of the things we're really interested in is how do you move across these different spaces, and what does that mean for the sort of material, how the kinds of materials that you pay attention to, the ways of reading that come with that, and the kind of narrative conventions that allow us to tell stories about social, historical, and mythic problems. So masks were really useful in a strain, have been really useful in a strain of this work, both as something that, you know, philosophically plays with a kind of object, subject, thing, being, non-being, set of parameters that are really kind of the questions of being, you know? So using masks as a kind of object that's both, you know, mythic, symbolic, that's a real material, but it's a material that you touch, a material that you read in one way in a distant theater space, but a material that you read another way in the kind of viewing mode of art. And so in performances and projects, we have used these to sort of translate from one medium to another. And, you know, we were drawn to it because we wanted to do, you know, kind of mythic, symbolic figures, kind of archetypal figures. We were relying a lot on kind of conventions of theater history to do that. And the kinds of, you know, genres that that introduces and the kinds of ways of reading that you can orient around those. And, you know, eventually, you know, when we thought about it as in relationship to identity, which was one of the framing questions here today, you know, we're a group of three people. We're all different. You know, we have kind of, you know, famous differences, even though we all sort of orient around a certain kind of, you know, generational perspective and other sort of coincidences. And our work is about working with groups and working in space beyond just sort of our own bodies. So, you know, we can't cohere around any kind of identity. So what became interesting to us is to play, you know, positions and attitudes and principles rather than sort of characters that have a kind of interior life construed around an identity position. And that, you know, is, you know, one thing in life. It's another thing in performance. It can be actually a lot more flexible, and you can try things on and take things off, as, you know, the other artists here have really already demonstrated. So, you know, in some of these works, like this was a Fassbinder play. We had all sort of been influenced by Fassbinder's company of theater and film and TV actors that he worked with. And I had written about Fassbinder, and he had described using his actors as dolls. So we thought, well, what if we adapted the play Blood on the Cat's Neck? But we played all of the roles, switching off, taking on the faces, and then later the sort of doll figures that represented different actors in that company. Or in Double Agency, which is very complicated and hard to explain in 5 minutes, you know, we were doing a project in LACMA, a performance project that was a video series. And we, as part of thinking about what it is to be a living object, an object subject in that space in the museum, part of this elaborate narrative we concocted to do that through involved us appropriating masks from their own collection and then making forgeries of those. And then those were used in the story, in the video performance, and were also, you know, returned back to LACMA, and they're here. You can see in the recent installation at the Whitney Museum, that was a 20-year survey of my barbarian's work. So you can see how they exist in relationship to video installation as well. So that's a very quick tour through some of our mask uses, and thanks for listening.
Thank you so much, Malik. Thank you, Colette. Thank you, Farah. I'm thrilled that you all presented on work that so clearly engages with masking, both in metaphoric and literal ways. I guess, Malik, a question I have for you is, My Barbarian puts theatricality back into performance art, and in a way that is very, you know, campy and exaggerated, but at the same time you're commenting on very real historical issues, right? So how do you navigate that fictional space of theater with the political reality, essentially?
Oh no, I don't hear
you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
No.
Am I here? Okay, good. Yeah, thanks. It depends on, you know, the piece, and a lot of times the approach to the piece is a lot more formal than it seems. You know, maybe it's something about the architecture, and the architect had a modernist idea of how to do performance. You know, we're like, all right, well, let's try and theatricalize that. But while you're doing that, of course, you can't help make fun of a modernist utopian idea of performance when you're trying to reenact it from this day and age. So there's already some distance built in. And then you can think about, well, what are the other kind of like things in the surround? Is it how the space is used? Is it the kind of history of the space? Is it a political history? Do we, you know, does this have to do with, you know, bigger political, you know, territorial problems, you know? So we usually approach it through those kinds of content questions, actually. But I think there's like a definitely a comfort with play and humor and the kind of suppositionality of, you know, camp and comedy and, you know, a lot of kind of folk forms that mm-hmm. I think we just as a group are really drawn to as a way to make performance.
Yeah. Thank you. And you all employ music in your work, which actually I wasn't familiar with that side of Farah's work. I knew that Colette was in a band, Justina and the Victorian Punks, and Malik, of course, My Barbarian. It's there's music in, I think, every performance that you do. It's all basically kind of show tunes, essentially. And so what role does music play for you in the performance of identity? Was it something that you instantly knew you were working with? Or in your case, Farah, I guess, how did you arrive at a piece where you decided to work with music? Even though I know that you wanted to be a musician first.
Colette, do you want to answer that first and then I can go?
Well, I can probably, it's very different than you. It's so interesting, the developments, you know. But for me, I was bored with the art world strict rules, you know. It was so old-fashioned in a way, you know. And I loved the freedom of music, but then again, I was using that as a, I should say, I stay away from politics, but art is a political act. So I died. That was a political act as a woman artist, you know. And ripping myself off, everything I've done in a way is, even though I did not, you know, I don't like to label it as that. So posing as a rock star was also a statement, you know, because at the time I felt if you were an entertainer, you would be taken more seriously as a woman, you know, than if women artists were non-existent or you had to act and look and do art like a man to be part of it. And I was just doing my thing. That's one aspect, but I can talk for hours, so go ahead. Thank you.
I think I arrived at it from a place of frustration also with visual art, and specifically that video was made at such a turning point for me because I was in grad school. I was going into my second year and I was so frustrated with photographs because I felt like I wasn't getting the answers from the work that I wanted. Of course, now I know that that's what graduate school is about, but I think I wanted to do something that was more immediate and just a little bit more of like a recitation of things that had been on my mind. And this was, of course, the height of anti-brown, black, Asian sentiment leading up to the election in 2016. So I felt like there was a lot of this energy bubbling up that needed to come out in a way that was more immediate than the visual work that I was doing was allowing me to. And I had played in punk bands for years since I was, you know, 13 or 14. So I thought, well, why don't I just perform a song and just bring a sort of visual aspect into it. So I rebuilt this version of my childhood bedroom and then became the kind of monster under the bed who was just like an analogy for this oppressive and intrusive presence in a space that's supposed to be at once, you know, protective, but also like kind of fraught in a lot of different ways. And so now I cheat because I'm able to still be a musician. I make all of the music for my films and it takes the pressure off because it's something that I think, you know, I can get away with doing it quietly. I don't perform anymore, even though I'd like to. But yeah, that was sort of how I came into it. I think it came out of a place of frustration.
Yeah. And is the title of that video, How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love My Room, is it a reference to the Kubrick film, How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love My Bomb, or The Bomb? And that's interesting because, you know, it's a dark comedy from the 60s. And I know that Malik, My Barbarian's double agency project was informed by a 1960s spy genre. So what is it about the 1960s in particular that attracted you guys?
And you know, on the music question, that's one of my favorite things was the double agency piece was, designed to be like a television series, like a thriller television series from the 60s about spies, and we were spies in the museum. So I had to develop TV music. I had to write a theme. I had to score all the episodes and so create like tension and drama and you know, play with those kind of like conventions of the genre. And I love doing all of that kind of stuff. And, you know, music is the core of my whole work, I'd say, you know. And everyone in my Barbarian has like a lot of fun and facility with music. And so it is sort of a very conventional through line, even in the sort of like Brechtian, you know, in the kind of Brechtian training that we all had as young people, the way that like music is used to denaturalize or to break through or something like that. But yeah, it definitely questions of, you know, identity come up when like composing for specific types of characters or figures or for yourself when you're like, what is the music that I want to be, you know, have coming through my body. You know, my Barbarian started as a band, and because of you know, we realized what we were doing was kind of performance art, and just because of the kind of looseness of the boundaries in LA at that time in history, and maybe a kind of like ill-defined turn toward performance in the art world. We found some opportunities to kind of turn it into a performance art project that then actually was sort of turned out to be what we were meant to do anyway. But part of that, you know, doing performance art, you know, you're always supposed to do something wrong in performance art. So part of that is doing music in the art space. You know, We really lean into genre a lot with music. So for that 60s piece, or with other 60s pieces that have been about, you know, utopian fantasies or our, you know, parents' generation or things like that, we take those cues seriously.
Mm-hmm. And Farah, for you, why the 1960s Kubrick film?
I don't know. I mean, I think, you know, I don't think I put an enormous amount of thought into the title, but I think it was this idea, this sort of like flippant idea of, well, I can go to love the thing that's threatening me. And I think it all boils down to this moment where, I watched Kubrick growing up. I watched a lot of films like on a sort of time delay because we would get films on TV, you know, a few decades after they came out. But at the time, I was, my phone calls were getting tapped by the NSA, and, you know, just like my calls to my parents back home. And one of the things that happened is there's a Christmas card that my mom sent me that arrived to New Haven 3 months late, and it was like torn apart, and it had a NSA sticker around it. It was like checked by the National Security Administration. And then one of the Santa's legs had been torn off. And that is you see it sort of in the video, that's the card. And it was just this very sweet, we don't even celebrate Christmas, but there was this very sweet message from my mom that was like, Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, love you, you know? And so the idea that this very kind of, you know, intrusive presence that had this idea about what the contents of that card might be. And it's just like my innocent, sweet mother. So for me, it was this kind of thing where I got accustomed to speaking back at whoever was listening in on my phone. We would hear lines cross, we would hear people breathing, our voices would be played back to us on a time delay. So it was this idea that like naming the elephant in the room is somehow normalizing it a little bit. So I think that that particular title felt like it carried that energy of, you know, of just sort of naming your monster and learning to live with it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you. And Colette, over to you. I'm curious, you truly were such a pioneer of performance art, but were you thinking about your work as performance art in the 1970s?
I wasn't thinking. In fact, I'm not a big fan of thinking. And I know that sounds strange, but I kind of follow a higher voice, I think, and try to manifest that visually. I think that's really what I understand to be the role of an artist, to be open to something higher and being to trust it and being able to manifest it in a way that others, you can share it with others. So I just did what I felt. And I think that's the most revolutionary thing you can do, is to be yourself, talking about masking and personas, you know? Because for me, mask, we all have different perceptions. For me, mask are hiding, you're hiding. And for me, a persona can reveal something higher or something that's more inspiring. Now, of course, the mask can be intriguing too and mysterious, you know, and there's positive aspects to it. Did I answer your question? I forgot it.
Yeah, you can keep going if you want. Yes, and this idea of sleeping as an endurance performance, essentially. How did you come up with that? Was it in reference to just being so bored with the art world?
Oh, no, this had nothing to do with it. I don't even remember what I told you, but I was very conscious of how many things I've done and I couldn't cram it all in. But sleeping was a very important part, because in most of my rooms, I would be laying there sleeping. Sometimes I look dead or sleeping, but you know, I explore dreams and reality. I explore the line between life and art, art and commerce. I love pushing to the limit, but I don't want to cross over. I just want to go as far. So something about laying there sleeping and the viewer going to this room, which is full of fabric, sometimes muted sound or audios. I like to incorporate all the arts. It created like an impression. This is what I'm after, creating an impression, an altered state in the viewer. And to be part of a whole room was very immediate. An artwork can do that, but an entire room. And so it was a big part of my work, and I slept in many of my rooms. And depending, like if it was Marat, I would be the dead Marat, you know? Sleeping gypsy without the lie, you know? I would appropriate a lot of artworks from art history, like I said before, mythology and literature, like Camille at the Museum of Modern Art.
And in relation to that, your costumes and the objects that you used, as well as Malik by Barbarians, the objects that you use in your performances, and Farah for you as well, all these props and costumes that you engage with, I'm wondering, do you imagine them as living on as a meaningful documentation of the work, or is it in some way still performing? So I guess what I'm asking is, can an archive perform?
Can an archive perform?
Yes.
I'm not sure I know what you mean, but for me, everything ends up being part of the art. Okay, there's a catalog from Berlin, okay? This is a costume I wore in a performance. I photographed myself in it. It was Lascaux for Romance, okay? I did a song written Lascaux for Romance before I went to Berlin. And it's a sculpture. And one of them was in the show, by the way. So does that answer your question? I like the idea of just using different medias where it gets recycled from a photograph to a light box to a performance. And, you know, it's all one in the end. It's many ways to manifest. And also, at the time I started, it was very, and well, the right words don't come to me, but the art world was more limited, you know? And I love incorporating all these other arts into my art, and yet not, you know, incorporating them, like almost as you use paint.
Yeah, so your personas live on through those objects, I think.
The objects live on after the personas. Yeah. In other words, if I would use props in a performance, the props later would be part of my artwork somehow. It would be recycled into it. they would be put in large boxes that end up in museums. Does that make sense? Yeah. I don't know.
And Malik, yes, it does. Absolutely. Thank you, Colette. And Malik, how about you? Because for me, the Whitney exhibition was the first time that I saw objects that Barbarian had utilized installed as a piece, essentially. Some of the masks were there. Was that the first time that you did that, or?
No, but that show was definitely about the question that you posed, like how can an archive be a performance also? And, you know, in my slideshow, I showed some of the other kind of installations that, you know, sometimes objects are made for both display and wear and for photography, you know. And then like, can they have like loan forms? Can we touch, you know, like you bring your art to the museum, you can't touch it anymore unless it's a prop. So then you can, but then it can't have the same insurance value. Like it's actually kind of a big set of problems that are kind of funny and kind of absurd once you start getting into it. But like, you know, can I do this? I don't think so. No, never mind. We had a large archive for this exhibition of things that were combinations of props, sculptures, masks, costumes, in all sorts of states of construction. And we found a way to make them all sort of work together as a kind of theatrical space.
And Farah, what about you? Do you hold on? Go ahead.
Me?
Oh, were you going to say something?
No, I was just thinking how the internet has changed everything. And I came before the internet. That's just the thought that's always with me when I get to know younger artists, you know?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And Farah, what is that like for you? Do you, because you utilize a lot of objects and props in your work, and then do you hold on to them or? What happens after?
That's a loaded question because I just moved studios and I had to really like have a come to God moment about how I was collecting things. One thing that I think about a lot is when I make puppets or when I'm making characters for a piece that have a physical manifestation, it's really hard for me to get rid of them because I feel like after a certain point, they don't belong to me anymore. Like they become their own thing. Like this puppet was designed to be very anxious. And part of him having hair is that you kind of see the manifestation of his anxiety and his movement and his hair. And I feel like he is who he is now. And I can't really take that away from him because I chose to bring him into this life, but he belongs to it now. He doesn't belong to me anymore. And so I feel that with all of my puppets and characters. So it's hard for me that kind of the material attached to it becomes sentimental. And so I do feel like it carries on a life of its own. I was also thinking when you asked that question about, I don't know if anyone's seen the Wattle Shelkey piece, Cabaret Crusades, where there are these beautiful marionettes that act out. Okay. It's a really beautiful, it's like these crazy videos that enact kind of, you know, this a very, very important part of history, but using these very realistic but also spooky marionettes. And he shows the marionettes just in like vitrines, and they most definitely are alive in a certain way. And it goes beyond that thing of people being spooked out by like Victorian dolls, you know. There is actually something, I believe, that when you make something, when a human makes something, figurative, there is a sort of like part of you that goes into it because you're making a life. There's like the process of sort of imbuing it with its own life. So I don't know. I'm not very spiritual or new agey, but that is one thing that I do believe because I have lived with these puppets for a few years now. And I do really feel like they maintain their own space in this world without my activation.
And have they been exhibited? Or do you envision them ever being exhibited alongside photographs and films?
Maybe. I'm afraid that someone would see my shoddy sewing skills, but maybe one day.
Thank you so much, Farah. I want to allow some room for you to ask each other questions if you have any, and then after that we can open it up to the audience.
I would love to ask Colette, you know, I saw your show at Company and it was so beautiful, and I'm just wondering what the experience was, you know, showing in a gallery in New York compared to, you know, doing the street work that you were doing, and how it felt to actually be working in a space that was welcoming it rather than a space that was actively trying to stop it.
Oh, that's a long story, but number one, I was always showing in museums and galleries. It was out of choice that I continued to use unorthodox spaces, you know? So it's nothing new. But what was interesting about this show, it was showing something old for me, you know, like, but it was like creating something new at the same time. And that was a very special experience. And Company, I love Company. I mean, you know, they were so great. And they really, I don't know, they really got it, you know, and the collaboration with Tazia and everyone else, you know, was just so organic. And Kento, who helped too, was a curator. It was really a very magical experience for me. And so to see the old work looking new again and having a young audience coming back to life, that was a new experience. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I was just generally curious about how it felt.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And what was it like to see all that? What was it like to see all that work from that time installed at Company?
It was wonderful because it, you know, it created distance, and yet I was so moved that so many young people appreciated it, because in my early years, even though I became famous right away, I didn't get the same support, and I don't think people got it, you know, but the young people got it. My work was known, I was known, but there was so much opposition, and, you know, it was wonderful, wonderful experience. Thank you.
We have a question from the audience. I'll read it. Somebody is asking, I don't know their name, can art truly remain authentic once it has been relegated to the world of mercantile, archival, and objectified? Question mark.
Yes.
I don't think anything is authentic. I think that authenticity itself is a heteronormative concept, but I'm curious what the artist.
You know, that's a very good question, because I'm surprised at my answer, because most people think, oh, I do these works, I destroy them, I don't care about this stuff, you know? But my answer was very immediate. And one reason is I look at, now that I'm older and I have a history, I look at art also as an archaeologist, which I always did in a way, because I love ruins. Ruins have been a big inspiration. I didn't mention that. And I think there's magic in these objects. They're like sacred objects, you know, like whether they're art or an artifact. That's my immediate response. It's a surprise to me as well.
Malik, I feel like you would have a good answer to this.
That's funny. I don't know. I mean, I feel like the question like asks about authenticity already in quotes, you know? So, I mean, we're reading, I don't know if the audience can all see this, but we're reading a version of the question as a text, or authentic is in quotes. So already is like, is it what's authentic, or is it what's like able to cite authentic? Is it what's able, can art be able to cite authenticity? And then like, is art authentic or is art not authentic? One thing, but the question about can it remain authentic says that it could be authentic and then become inauthentic. And that's a really interesting way to think about art, as like situational, like that, like in one place it's authentic, mm-hmm. and another place it's not. I mean, you know, I feel like as a, you know, middle-aged artist who by no means had some kind of like, you know, silver spoon art career, but who had a kind of survey show at a major museum. The work, some people can think it looks really like objectified and classified in a certain way. But I was actually really happy to have that opportunity because the work was really about those questions, you know, about objectification and about classification. And so even though we made the work totally thinking it could be ephemeral and just disappear, as, you know, a person in my late 40s, I'm kind of happy that my life's work didn't just disappear and could can be like articulated in this way.
That's a great answer. And Farah, I'm curious about your thoughts about authenticity and also, I guess, the authenticity of culture.
I think I, similarly to you, have some just prickles at that word, because I keep thinking if there's a painter whose authentic goal is to sell paintings and make money, and that is what the work does, then who are we to say that that's inauthentic? It absolutely is, because it's true to the kind of impulse, right? It's true to the, I don't know, the genesis of making the work. It might not be something that, you know, we identify with, but I think this idea of authenticity, I often question it, because I think maybe it also goes back to something that Colette said earlier about, you know, doing the work because you have to, or because you feel like it's this sort of current that's running through you in a way. And maybe there are aspects of the process that respond to like research or respond to thought or conversation. But I do feel like, I don't know. I feel like there is, I think it always becomes complicated when the idea of a market is introduced, or the idea of like an objectified work of art is introduced, because it is impossible to ignore those things. But I also think that there are ways to sort of protect those impulses that feel sort of like pure and feel like they're really rooted in a kind of questioning that a lot of people can hopefully identify with. So so I think that the answer is I'm not sold on the word authentic as something that is useful for me personally. But I do think that, you know, a lot of it is responding to an impulse and trying to sort of protect that impulse from outside sources that are not, you know, that are not from a place of a kind of interested, curious questioning.
And I don't think we can make it that general, because in the end, it's not whether it's an object or a performance or a relic. I think it's what it is, because not every painting is authentic. Not every performance artist is authentic, you know? So if it speaks to you and it carries some kind of magic that touches you, it's authentic, whatever it is. I mean, that's my final response to art. Other people's
emotion can be authentic, perhaps. On that note, I'm gonna wrap it up. Thank you to the three of you so much. Thank you for hanging in there through the tech issues. It was wonderful to listen to you speak. And I think, I don't know.
Thank you.
What? They're this just gonna go black now?
Thank you.